that talent. Remarkable, isn't it? Just a week ago, we gathered here and talked about the resurrection appearance of Jesus at the tomb. And the Bible goes on to talk about other appearances of Jesus. Two men were walking home to the town of Emmaus, and this stranger came and walked along with them. And they didn't know who he was until they got home, and they invited him in for a meal, and he broke the bread. And as soon as they broke the bread, they realized that Jesus had been walking with them. Jesus had appeared to his disciples when they were locked behind doors, hiding in Jerusalem. He had appeared to them as they had gone back up north, back up to Galilee, fishing on the Sea of Galilee. In fact, John, who wrote the Revelation, one of the last times he saw Jesus was cooking breakfast on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. And they had been out fishing all night and caught nothing. And he hollered at them, throw your nets on the other side. And then they hauled in more fish than they could count. And when they got to the shore, Jesus was cooking breakfast. It was a way to say, see, I provided for you at the feeding of the 5,000, and I still provide for you here after the resurrection. But now we are 60 years later, and persecution has scattered the church out of Jerusalem. The Romans have destroyed Jerusalem. In 69 AD, the Romans had had enough of these pesky Jews. And if we just destroy their capital, then they will disperse. And the Romans destroyed the temple, they destroyed homes, they destroyed agriculture. And the church, early church leaders, the 12 apostles, first Judas was already dead and replaced by Matthias, they fled. And as John fled, he went to one of the most logical places in the ancient world. He went to a city called Ephesus. It was on the Mediterranean. We now call it Turkey. It was a major port city in those days. And John went to Ephesus, and John began to build the church. As the church fled, they carried the story of Jesus with them, and churches began to spring up all over the ancient world. If you can get a picture of the Mediterranean in your head and just take a crayon and color a whole bunch of lines all the way around the Mediterranean, can you see that in your head? That's the Roman Empire. And as the Romans destroyed Jerusalem, they sent the church throughout the Roman Empire. And John settled in Ephesus and became a very respected elder, a leader in the church. Well, the Bible doesn't tell us much about what happened to the disciples, the original 12. A tradition tells us that they all were martyred except John, who lived to be an old guy. And he had founded a number of churches, probably at least these seven churches that he is writing the letter to. He is like the bishop over these seven churches. Now, in those years, Rome had changed too. When Paul was writing, the Romans could be seen as more or less a fairly benevolent government. But now, 40 years later, 20 years later, John is writing, Domitian has come to the throne. Domitian was the little brother of Titus. He was never supposed to be a Caesar. He was by far his daddy's second choice as his successor. Domitian had a real inferiority complex, and he compensated by it by demanding that he be worshipped as a god. And so the people were demanded, the Romans demanded, that Domitian be worshipped. That included here in Turkey, where John is living. And the soldiers were sent with golden images of the emperor. That if you would but kneel down and say, Caesar Domitian is Lord and God, you could go on about your business. And those words stuck in the jaws of the Christians. Because they had one confession. Christ is Lord. And so John, because he refuses to bow down to the Romans, and because he refuses, he encourages his church members not to bow down to Romans, he is sent to a prison on the island of Patmos. So he's out in the Mediterranean on a big rock, not unlike Alcatraz. And he is so wanting to be with his church over on the mainland on Sunday morning. And in my mind's eye, I see John standing on the beach, looking across the water, wondering how he can get the word to his church who is suffering. They are experiencing tribulation. John says, I am your brother in tribulation. We'll come back to it in a minute. But the word tribulation is from the word to crush. It's what you have to do to wheat to make flour, and olives to make olive oil, and grapes to make wine. You have to tribulate them. You have to crush them. And John says, I am your brother in tribulation. And all of a sudden, he hears behind him the voice that sounds like a trumpet, like the Son of Man. John has not heard this voice for 60 years. He was a young, hot-headed. Jesus called him Son of Thunder. Kind of tells you John didn't do anything quietly. And now he's an old man and he hears this voice. And it sounds like the trumpets of victory. That is crazy, right? Because he's on a prison. And this voice sounds like trumpets, and he hears the voice, and he knows instantly, it's my Lord. And he turns, and he sees seven lampstands, lamps on candles, more or less, on stands. And he understands that these are the seven churches that John is responsible for. And he sees that Jesus is standing beside the lampstands. Is that what the text says? Look at the text. Does it say he stands beside? No. Is he standing above? No. Jesus is in the middle of these lampstands. Jesus stands among his church. He is not away from us, apart from us. He is among us. And he looks, and this man standing there is wearing a robe. He has become the high priest, who is at this very moment pleading our case, interceding for us before God. Do you know that right now, wherever heaven is, Jesus is pleading your case as your priest? But this priest has a golden sash. Priests didn't wear golden sashes. Kings wear golden sashes. This king has conquered death. This king rules the world. And his hair and head are white. I'm glad Jesus had white hair. The Bible says in Proverbs 16:31, you need to circle this in your Bible. White hair is a crown of glory. It is attained by a righteous life. There you go, right here. I got proof. Some of you are covering up your righteousness. I'm just saying. Don't hide your righteousness. But anyway, his white, the color of purity. of righteousness. And his eyes were like Superman's. You know, I can't help but think of Superman. Blazing fire. You can tell I was a child in the 70s, 60s and 70s. I think of Superman with that X-ray vision. But long before Superman had X-ray vision, Jesus. These eyes are lasers that penetrate through. They see everything. The one who is standing there on the beach, appearing to John, knows what you're doing, where you are, what you need. He knows because he sees. And his feet were bronze. They didn't have steel. They had bronze. That was the hardest metal known. His feet are sturdy. He is solid. You can't tip him over. He can't be bullied. And his voice sounds like rushing water. You ever been to Niagara Falls? You need to go. You cannot have a conversation with someone standing at Niagara Falls unless you want to shout at them. Because as that water comes over that waterfall, it drowns out every other noise. It is the most amazing force of power in nature I think I've ever seen. It is remarkable. Honestly, when before we went, I thought, big fat hairy deal, what's water over rocks? And you get there and you realize, this is unlike anything else in the world. This voice that came out of Jesus was like the sound of Niagara Falls. It had authority. It drowned out every other sound. And in his hand, he was holding seven stars. John will later tell us that these stars are the leaders of each of these churches. There's an old adage that if you want to kill a snake, you cut off the head of the snake, right? You don't get its tail, you get the head. I heard back during the beginning of the Iraq War, we're going after Saddam Hussein, because to kill the snake, you take the head of the snake. The Romans thought the same thing. If we get the leaders of these churches, the pastor, the chair of deacons, the minister of music, if we can get the leaders of these churches, then we'll destroy these churches. But Jesus says, gotcha. They're right here. I'm holding them in my hand, and Rome cannot take them from me. And out of his mouth, now it gets weird. Out of his mouth comes this double-edged sword, because he speaks with authority and decisiveness and judgment. And his face is shining. Remember when Moses came down from the mountain where he'd been with God? He had to put a veil over his face because his face was shining. Jesus has been in the presence of God. This is a resurrection appearance of Jesus. He is living and holy and majestic and all-knowing and authoritative and powerful. And he stands in the middle of his church. And he holds our destiny in his hands. And he holds the key to death and hell. Rome doesn't hold the key to death and hell. Cancer doesn't hold the key to death and hell. Your doctor does. Jesus holds the keys of life and death. So what's the message? Don't be afraid. He knows where you are. He knows what you need. He is able to provide for you. He holds your life in his hands. In the meantime, though, we do experience tribulation, don't we? We experience that grinding. Let's think about that grinding for a moment. If you go to Wendy's from here, and you order the classic bacon double cheeseburger with extra pickles, or whatever it is you like, and they give you the meat and the cheese and the pickles and the ketchup and the mustard, and then they put a bunch of wheat on both sides. Can you eat that? Not very well. And it would be very good. Right? Because wheat is only valuable once it's ground into flour. And if you go home this afternoon and bake some of those chocolate chip cookies that some of you are known for, and you say, I'm not gonna grind the wheat this time, I'm just gonna throw in those kernels. Emily, your cupcakes wouldn't be very good, would they? Just what would Trey do if you just threw him some wheat in there instead of ground the flour? That grain is only valuable once it's been transformed into something else. I like olives, but I really like olive oil. So if I threw some asparagus on the grill and I just decided to throw some olives on there with them, it wouldn't be very good. But if I ground that, pressed those olives and made olive oil, and then put that on the asparagus, that's pretty good stuff, right? Olive oil is only valuable once it's been crushed. And if you come to my house and you think we're having wine for dinner, you'll probably be disappointed. But I'm not going to serve you wine, I'm going to serve you grapes in a glass. You're going to think that's kind of weird, right? I'll serve you red grapes or white grapes, whatever we're having for dinner, right? Because grapes only become wine when they're crushed. It's why, and the instant you crush them, they start to ferment, the very moment. It's why ancient people saw wine as a gift from God, because it was a natural occurrence. It was not something man-made, not distilled or fermented. It was, what do you do with beer? I don't know what you do with beer. But the second you make wine or grapes into juice, it starts becoming wine. The truth is that tribulation in our lives is what's needed to make us useful to God. Oswald Chambers wrote a classic daily devotional book called My Utmost for His Highest. Many of us have copies sitting on our shelves that mine, I think I got it for the first time when I was a student, way, 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 way back. But on September the 30th, his devotion on September the 30th, I circled in my devotional book, and I go back to that. I don't read him daily, but I go back to that one quite often. He writes, "We long to be useful, to be made ground up wheat and wine, flour and wine, but we object to the instruments of his pressing, what he uses to transform us. If we can see our trials, our problems, as the tools that God uses to transform us into what he wants us to be, then only then can we see how he makes us useful to himself. Many of us say, Lord, I want to be wine for you. I want to be olive oil. I want to be flour. I want to be useful to you, but you can't use these things to press me. You can't use this person or this circumstance or this illness. And rather than becoming pressed and transformed, we become hard like marbles. If you press a marble, All you get is broken glass. Bitter. Useless. Worthless. We become unyielding. What the Bible calls stiff-necked. Refusing to bow our heads. But only when we are transformed do we become fit for the kingdom's work. It's a hard thing to understand that when we pray for our church, we're praying for our church to grow, we're praying for tribulation, difficulty. And the decision a church has to make is the same as a church as the decision an individual has to make. Will we allow Jesus to use these trials to transform us? Or to make us brittle and bitter? I've told you before, when I was in Palestine a couple years ago, I went to church on Sunday morning. It was a Greek or Arabic-speaking Greek Orthodox church. I understood nothing. Probably the best service I've been in years. I'm not a, lasted 3 hours. Packed with young adults. Every church I know of in Jefferson County is praying, Lord, send us young adults. Here's how you do it. You take away the people's jobs and livelihoods. You limit their opportunities to travel, to find employment and education. You take away their olive groves and their water sources and the farms that have been in their families for hundreds of years. And you oppress them. That's how you make a church grow. Because the church was packed. Tribulation comes. It came to John the Apostle. But when tribulation comes, so does Jesus. He stands among us. He becomes our high priest and our king. He speaks with authority. He speaks in judgment and decisively. He sees. He comes in righteousness. He comes as king to rule over us. And he stands among us and he holds us in his hand. For we are his and he is ours. This is the last resurrection appearance of Jesus in the New Testament. Until John writes that he comes in victory. One day he will come for us. Will he find us faithful, obedient, pliant? Or will he find us stiff-necked and resistant and bitter? Let's pray together. Oh Lord Jesus, this is your church. We are your people. And I know that you stand among us. We know that. We felt that. We have sensed that. We've seen you at work. And so take away our fear of what's to come, oh God. For whatever happens, you hold us in your hand. Take away our fear of dying, our fear of a disability, for you hold us. And give us a courage to be transformed. That when difficulties come, we will become better and not bitter. That we will become more like you and less like ourselves. We open our hearts to you, O Lord, this morning as we pray in faith, believing that you hold us in your hands. As it's in your name we pray. Amen.